far, so bear with me. Apparently the camera is my best friend at the moment, so I'm going to keep looking at the camera. Anyway, we're going to go through the latest pest and disease update that we found over the last 12 months or so on poinsettias, but I will include a lot of other crops as well, because I know you all grow other crops, not just poinsettia. So, the latest from the ministry and from around the country, aphids are certainly on the increase, and we are finding a lot of aphid species on a range of different plants, including poinsettia. At the moment, it's been the peak potato aphid has been the most common one, although last year we found the glasshouse potato aphid causing yellowing on the underside of the leaves. Thrips, a new species of thrips, it's the Japanese, or as people are calling it, the eastern flower thrips, thripsitosis. However, this is not just a flower thrips. It feeds predominantly on the leaf, so calling it a flower thrips is probably wrong. It does a lot more serious damage to the underside of leaves, where it will establish and cause big colonies. Whitefly, species again, people mistaking the honeysuckle whitefly for Vermisia. They are completely different if you know what you're looking for. Spider mite, the Lewis mite, has been around more last year than this year so far, but it has been a bit of an issue. And again, we found a bit more bacterial leaf spot. I'll go to that a bit later. Okay, looking at the various pests, I think you should all be able to identify aphids. So the biological control, Aphidius colmanae, I would advise putting the ervi in as well as the mix. That gives you a good range of parasitoids to cover a range of different aphid species. The rates, as you can see on the screen there, 1 to 2 per square meter per fortnight, but just over the area that you find the aphids. If you do need to spray, we have found that chess at the lower rate is giving a very good result on poinsettias, and it can be mixed with a plant growth stimulator if necessary. Main man is also giving a good result on aphids, but again, check with phytotox if we're not 100% certain on main man. Now onto the thrips. It is very, very similar to Western flower thrips, hence why we're calling it the Eastern flower thrips, just to identify the two. Difference in colour, it's a dark brown, it's a rusty black looking colour, but with a spot on its rear side where the wings fold together. It will transmit viruses, exactly the same as Western flower thrips. Life cycle is the same. Damage is more silvering, much more serious damage on the underside of the leaf. Photograph in the middle there shows the damage on hibiscus leaf. That is the characteristic thripsitosis with that blotch on the back of it. Thrips on the right-hand side is a cereal thrips. They're both black, but the cereal thrips does not have that white or greyish band across the back. Okay, moving straight on to whitefly. Obviously, we've got the glasshouse whitefly is predominantly the common one and should be the only one we have. However, the Vermisia tabaci, the cotton whitefly, is around and it has been found on 1 or 2 nurseries this year. And we do find it on poinsettias as well as hibiscus, dipodenia, and other plants like this which are coming across from Italy. Not Italy, not just Italy, other countries as well. Okay, identification. Glasshouse whitefly, pupal stage. If you can find the pupa, roll the leaf to the side, check the edge of the leaf, and it should look like a small or miniature pork pie. So straight sides, slightly dome top, and that's your glasshouse whitefly. If it is dome shaped from the edge and look more like a Cornish pasty, then that's the Vermisia tabaci. So that's easy identification from the pupal stages. The honeysuckle whitefly is a different genus altogether. This is an Anaerobes genus, and they have a chevron, a little grey mark, on each wing. They hold their wings much flatter. The photograph that I've shown is of a strawberry plant, and that is honeysuckle whitefly on strawberries. Last year we found it attacking several nurseries with poinsettia. Unfortunately, the ministry came in, looked at the pupal stages, identified it on site as Vermisia, and shut down all plant movement. So again, be totally aware that this is not Vermisia tabaci. If you can find the adults, check them out and they will look like this. It's not a notifiable species. control. I think everyone's using it at the moment, the Incarcia. Incarcia and Reposeris mix, 50-50 mix. Most suppliers are supplying this mix. Very, very useful. It covers all your glasshouse whitefly, the misia, and your Reposeris will also do the honeysuckle whitefly to a certain extent. Macrolophus will not work on Poinsettia, but if you have aubergines, and we use those as a banker and trap plant, so we have the aubergines growing to the first flower stage, introduce the Macrolophus, and then introduce the plants in amongst the greenhouse, any whitefly migrating in will go to the aubergine, where we have the predator set up as a trap to control the whitefly. It honestly works a treat. The pathogens, obviously we still have Canicillium lecarni, Mycotel, and we have Bavaria bassiana as either Botanigard or Naturalis. Provided you can get the humidity, the environment correct, you will set up an establishment and they will take out entire colonies of whitefly. This is probably best used at the very young stage of poinsettias when they've just come in from the supplier, and you can take mix it with nematodes to give you the full range of sclera control and whitefly control in an easy treatment at that stage. Sticking to whitefly, I think you should be aware that Novento has been causing some problems. We had a brand new EAMU set out in June of this year. The number has changed, but the date, check that one out. I'm bringing to your attention explanatory note number 5, which by now you should have read. Basically, it says that if you use Novento, it's at your own risk. You have no comeback for any crop damage or lack of efficacy from that product. The reason for this is over the last few years, we have found severe damage to certain plants. Some plants, it's minor damage. Other plants, like Alstomera, it has actually just literally welded the top of the plant against the flower buds, just aren't opening. Instead of being a nice bunch of flowers, they're stuck together as they grow. I've even heard the stems crack on the aubergine that they've been opening. The Astromira as they're growing in the greenhouse. So that's a photograph there, and you can see the damage. That should be an open bunch, and the whole head of the plant was literally just sticked together and would not grow at all. But this has caused severe damage on Astromira, even the young plants coming up, because it's a rhizome, they're coming up with that severe scorch damage. Okay, I mentioned spider mites. The Lewis mite, proper name is Eotetranicus, and that is attacking poinsettias. It's flatter, slightly smaller, and yellower than the ordinary two-spotted spider mite. Our common glasshouse spider mite is Tetranicus urticae. This one is Eotetranicus, again, different genus. Itosulus, that we would normally use for spider mites, is not particularly good on this spider mite. What we have found is that Ambrosius andersoni is a better predator. Now, realistically, I don't think you're going to introduce andersoni over an entire crop of poinsettias to control a pest that may or may not appear, but if you do find it, it's probably not worth going down the line of Phytosulus. Give the plants a couple of sprays with Dynamec. Okay, be aware that Dynamec will upset the Incarcia and the Reposeris, but knock out the spider mites, topping up with some andersoni, and go back in with your parasitoids for whitefly control. That's the best advice we can give at the moment. Again, as I said, I'm not talking just on poinsettias today. The Lewis mite will attack a whole range of other crops. So again, just be aware that it's got a very wide host range. A bit like the Japanese thrips, it's going to spread, and it's going to spread rapidly. Okay, out of my comfort zone now on bacterial diseases. This is a Xanthomonas leaf spot. And you can see it's a black or brown necrotic lesions in the centre of the leaf with a yellow halo around the edge. It starts off as minute yellow black spots with that halo, but it spreads very rapidly. The warmer the temperatures, the higher the humidity, the worse it's going to get. Now, this has been found locally to us in West Sussex, and it's on poinsettias, and they have come across from Ethiopia. It's been around for the last 10, 11 years. Odd outbreaks every now and then. It's a various Xanthomonas species, and subspecies is the name, but just call it bacterial leaf spot. Now, if you do see it, we have no direct antibiotics allowed in the UK. We have copper-based fungicides that they were withdrawn last year. The only one we have now is a copper-based nutrient supplement, and that's only where there's a recognised need to apply copper. On the positive side, serenade, Bacillus subtilis, has some direct activity on bacteria, but also that triggers the plant's natural defence mechanisms. This is the acquired systemic resistance or induced systemic resistance. Looking through the literature, Amistar, Signum, so basically the scrobilurins, do exactly the same, and also T34 has the ability to trigger the plant's ASR response. Now this is systemic to the plant, not particularly long-lived, maybe 2 to 3 weeks of activity, but it does give a good defence against the bacterial leaf spots. So again, honest advice, if you can, incorporate T34 in the compost up front, and that will take care of a lot of pathogens that you might find. Hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, is a product called Endosan, which is a stabilised hydrogen peroxide solution. That can go through the irrigation system, and from all of the evidence that we've seen so far, it should have a very good effect as a preventative in the root zone and on the plants themselves. There's also a very useful AHDB PC291 fact sheet or technical notes on bacterial diseases. Well worth getting a hold of a copy of that. Okay, that's the end of my presentation. I'd like to thank you very much for your attendance and attention. Any questions that you may have, please feel free to contact Wayne Brough, who's sitting in the audience, or contact me by email, and I will try and answer them over the next few days. Very many thanks, and goodbye. Bye.